Good evening. My name is Scott Lamline, and on behalf of Susan Pinkerton, our record rector, and Douglas Highland, the president of our concert series, I welcome you to St. John's Church and the Music at the Red Door concert series here. So delighted you're here on this evening for what's going to be a wonderful concert, and hope you'll come again for one of our other great events that are coming forward. You have a program, and your program on the outside has a nice glossy folder that contains information about our upcoming events, and I hope you'll take that with you and make a note of the things we have ahead, including some wonderful choral music, including at our choral evensong services, the Celtic Fire event coming up, and our choir is very busily preparing for a performance of the Durufle Requiem later at the end of March, all of which will be wonderful, beautiful choral events like you're experiencing today, and so I do hope you'll come back. We'd love to invite you personally to these events, so if you're not on our email list, there are clipboards at the back of the church and at the front, and if you sign up, we'll send you messages on a regular basis to make sure you know that these things are happening. So again, thank you for being here, and if you'll join us at the end of the concert, there will be a brief intermission, and if you're wondering and haven't looked yet, this is not the entire Messiah, so it will not be a full three-hour event. Sorry for some of you who are disappointed in that, but there will be an intermission, and at the end of the concert, you are more than welcome to join us for a festive reception in the church hall to your right, out through this door. And they have CDs available for sale there if you'd like to make those available to yourself at that time. Messiah is probably the greatest known choral work. It's a truly timeless piece of music. And it's timeless for good reason. It's amazing music, and perhaps no other piece of music takes the Christian message, the life of Christ, and brings it to life in the same way as this work does, to the point where many of us who know music associate the great words of the Bible with these melodies, and these melodies bring those words back. And so it's just so beautiful to have it presented. We're about at the midpoint between Christmas and Easter right now during the season of Epiphany. And in our conversations about when to have Messiah, should we have it at Christmas time when everyone else does one? Should we have him at Easter? Have it at Easter time when everyone's kind of done? Or should we have it during Lent, during which we would have to put alternate words to the Hallelujah chorus, which I don't think that goes so well. So we pick now during Epiphany, right at the midpoint, where we can look at the life of Christ in a whole, at the whole, and consider it and have it come alive through this music. So I hope you'll sit back, enjoy that, and join me now in welcoming Mark Bailey and the American Baroque.
Good evening, and thank you for being here for this wonderful opportunity again to consider this great masterpiece at the midpoint of its story and the impact that has on the music and how we hear the music. Another element that we're excited to share with you about Messiah is that there actually isn't just one Messiah. There are many possibilities and many versions, because Handel would keep revising the work every time it was performed. It was performed several times during his life, and depending who he had singing and playing for him, he would do some revisions, sometimes write entirely new pieces, and left us with a wealth of material to select in order to create some sort of special theme or some sort of special feel catered to you and the particular circumstances. Now, one of the things to keep in mind is that when we hear Messiah performed today, it's usually the later version. It's usually how Handel sort of left it at the time of his death with whatever state was in there. And it had grown significantly. The orchestra had grown, added instruments, the choir had gotten bigger. But his initial inspiration for the work reflected a different mindset. He wrote the work, by the way, within a month. So it was really flowing out of him. The creativity was extraordinary. And initially, those performances tended to be rather intimate, like ours. There were no wind instruments, no oboes, for instance, there were some brass. But the performing forces were a little bit more on the humble side, the intimate side, so we could, those audiences really felt very much a part of it. And then, of course, it grew later. So we are reflecting Handel's initial inspiration for the work, some of his first creative thoughts when he put this masterpiece together. And we actually are using some of those pieces you rarely or probably never hear because other pieces supplanted them. But tonight, you'll get to hear what he had in his mind when this was first flowing through his creative genius. So again, thank you for being here as we consider the beginning and the end at the point of the middle. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
It's